is a great pleasure for me to introduce him. He won the Dirac Medal for his fundamental contribution to substring theory, in particular for the discovery of the deep brains. So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome the Dirac Medalist in 2008, Professor Georges Polchinski.
Okay. So it's
which one?
It's Polchinski, ICTP. Is this on?
Yes.
Okay. So this was a difficult talk to prepare, both because of the broad audience and the constrained time. So I thought I would start with a picture. And Dirac said that our theories should be beautiful. And I think this picture is beautiful, not necessarily for its artistic qualities, though I like them. It's beautiful, though, because it captures, in a simple way, a deep physical connection. So let me tell you what you're seeing there. First, in the background, you're seeing a representation of a certain curved space-time, a so-called charged anti-de Sitter black hole, or maybe black brain. Actually, when I saw this, I thought it's a bit stylized. And I thought it had been drawn by an artist, but it turns out it was actually drawn by one of the graduate students on the collaboration, Nabil Iqbal. And again, it kind of captures both the end of the sitter far away, and there's a throat there. The second element, that arrow whizzing by with the psi, tells you that you're supposed to simply solve the Dirac equation in this curved space geometry. And the last bit, the inset, is the resulting Green's function, the resulting linear response. And what this, this is the response to the function of momentum and frequency. And what this tells you is that this system is a strange metal. That is, oops, let me go back if I may. Is there a way to go back? Oh, there must be. There we are. So there's a singularity in the response at some non-zero momentum, which tells you there's a Fermi surface. But the response is broader in frequency than it would be for a Fermi surface, telling you that the decay, the interactions are stronger than they should be. Now, strange metals have been seen before. They've been seen in the phase diagrams for high TC superconductors and for heavy fermion materials and elsewhere. And they've been known for at least 20 years, and they're very mysterious. They're mysterious because there's a well-established theory of metals, of conductors, the Landau-Fermi liquid theory, which is very robust. It's very infrared attractive, and it's hard to deviate from it in an interesting way. And evidently what's happening is that the fermions are interacting with some other subsystem, some bath, which is causing them to decay and slowing them down. But even with that clue, it's hard to determine the nature of this bath. Now, yet this black hole accomplishes it. You can doubt, certainly. You can certainly be skeptical that there is any connection between this picture and the real materials, although there is an interesting convergence, because attempts to understand this phase have led to the idea that the bath that the fermions couple to has an exotic property known as local criticality. That is, it's invariant under scaling of time but not space, which means it has very strong low energy fluctuations. And this local criticality is exactly the same thing that is that holds in the low energy ADS2 throat of the black hole. So who knows? But the point really is not, well, it would be cool to understand the real materials in this way. The point, I'd really like to take a step back, though, and just say, you know, isn't this amazing that one can solve the Dirac equation and the Einstein-Maxwell equations and recover physics of an exotic phase in condensed matter physics? Where did that come from? And of course, where that came from is gauge gravity duality, this remarkable discovery, which is really not that old. It was really not known and really not suspected before 1997. I mean, there were hints from various directions, but certainly I think no one saw its full form. And what this means is that quantum field theory, particularly gauge theory, which is something that we understand pretty well, and gravity, which has many mysteries, are really in some ways the same. You can say that they're the same theory expressed in different variables, or you can say that there is some quantum theory and these are two different classical limits. And when you such a remarkable connection has implications in both directions. Again, it allows you to use what you know about Einstein gravity to solve some strongly coupled gauge theories. Here's another exotic phase of matter, which up until this week existed only in New York. It's a quark-gluon plasma formerly produced only at the Rick accelerator on Long Island. But as of Monday of this week, this phase is being produced at a somewhat higher temperature at the LHC. And again, it's an exotic phase because one might have thought that this would be a gas, a weakly interacting system. But it turns out that at the temperatures that are relevant, it's a very strongly interacting system. It is much more liquid-like than gas-like. Another way to say it is it has very low viscosity. And this puts it in the right regime where the gravitational description of something like this is simpler and useful. And in fact, the gravitational description gives a notion of an ideal liquid, a maximum interaction, or at least an ideal rate of interaction, 1 over 4 pi for this ratio. And the real materials, well, there's a big uncertainty, but come within a factor of 2 of this. Now, again, the theory you can solve is not exactly the QCD, not exactly the strong interaction that we have in nature. But this is a phase which is so complicated and for which there are no other tools. And so having a solvable system that is even in the right phase is tremendously valuable. And so in some sense, this is a harmonic oscillator for gauge theory plasmas. And the value goes beyond this one number, the viscosity that one often hears about. In Shiraz Manwala's very nice talk yesterday, he talked about advances in the understanding of relativistic hydrodynamics. That was thought to be a well-understood theory, purely abstractly, but having a solvable model made people realize that they hadn't fully understood it and it had more wrinkles than people had recognized. And there are other exotic phases where this kind of picture may be useful. OK, so that's using the duality in one direction, using gravity to understand gauge theory. But most of my talk is about the other direction, because gravity, after all, is the mystery, the thing that we want to understand. So one can call what one has here, you could call it emergent gravity, emergent as in the sense of emergent gauge symmetry, other kinds of emergence, where you have a starting point, which is sort of a fundamental description, which doesn't have gravity, doesn't have this property, yet somehow the strong dynamics produce it. And in fact, right now, this is our most complete formulation of any theory of quantum gravity. And I haven't mentioned string theory yet, but in seemingly all of the examples, when gravity emerges in this way, then in fact all the rest, the strings and the brains and the extra dimensions, seem to emerge as well. So this is kind of a busy transparency, and I'll try not to say too much about it, but I sort of wanted to, in one transparency, describe the discovery of these ideas. I like to think of, especially quantum gravity, where there are no real experiments, of physics being organized in terms of thought experiments. Well, thought experiments have been useful many times in the past as well. And so this shows a series of thought experiments spanning 20 or 30 years, thinking about gravitational scattering led to the idea of replacing points with strings, asking what those strings do in a small space, led to the recognition that there was more to string theory than the strings, also these D-brains. Asking what happens when you sort of turn on and off the gravitational coupling constant led to the recognition that these D-brains had some intimate connection with black holes and black brains. And finally, thinking about the dynamics and about especially this remarkable thought experiment of Hawking's, the black hole information paradox, led to Wan's realization that there was this duality that I'm talking about. Actually, there are many other threads to this discovery. There's supergravity, which Sergio talked about. There's Tuft's large N limit. There's Polyakov's gauge string duality. This is really the culmination and the confluence of many, many trains of thought over the last, well, I guess 45 years more or less. That would take us back to, what, 1965? That's about the beginning of string theory. Okay, good. Another lesson here. Well, the main lesson I want to draw from this is the following. These are some pretty abstract thought experiments, black hole information and so on, even the black strings in a box. And, you know, you can wonder, you know, is this the right way to make progress? Is this the right way to think? And one sign that it is that it has given us back things that we didn't put into it. And again, coming back to Shiraz's talk, there is this remarkable connection between fluid mechanics and Einstein's equations for general relativity, which could have been discovered by just looking at the equations and, you know, looking at them in the right way, but that's not how it was discovered. It was discovered through this bizarre series of thought experiments, which led to a result which, in the end, has many implications that have nothing to do with D-brains or strings or anything else. And so I just think, I don't know, I just like this as an illustration of the effectiveness of thought experiments. Because that's been the experience in string theory. String theory has a strange history. It takes you places you don't expect to go, but you try to ask the right questions and you get somewhere interesting. The other comment is that the strings are way up here at the top. They're only a stepping stone. They're a very effective stepping stone. They have a lot of information on them, but they're only a stepping stone towards what is now our closest approximation, I think, to the theory of quantum gravity.